Okay, well, I'm the last one. I'll try and finish by that just before five, because that's an important time for everybody, I guess. So, I'm Richard Self. I'm from the University of Derby. My main area of interest is governance of big data. What's it mean for us? How do we get value? How do we avoid having some problems? And what I'm going to talk about today covers both HPC side of stuff and the more businessy side of stuff. So we have a research relationship with the ALICE project in CERN, where the fundamental issue comes from the two fundamental definitional Vs of big data, volume and velocity. And we're trying to help them develop some ideas about handling that velocity and that volume. But also, I'm much more interested in myself on the more business side. That's actually a Facebook connections graph. Probably many people have seen before. Just so where big data analytics governance covers. I don't know if you've seen on the web the context that I put out. It's based on about 40 years experience in the business, industry for about 30 odd years, and the last 15 years in academia. In fact, my life has lasted longer than the field of commercial computing. I was born a couple of years before Leo was created, the first commercial computer in the world. One of the things I've noticed over many, many years is that IT, in the broadest sense, is considered by many, many people, and particularly those at the top of organizations, as the magic pixie dust. You sprinkle a little bit of it on it on a problem, and the problem kind of magically evaporates. And of course, we all know that doesn't actually happen. There's an awful lot of hard work goes into making this stuff work. And then I want to move on a little bit about this idea of big data and also the idea of small data, because they do two very, very different things. And if we get mixed up between what big data can tell us and what we can learn from small data, then we end up in big problems. Yes, it's big data. And Pierre was saying about statistics. And in statistics, there's always a question in academia, which is your sample frame? You know, the totality of who you could go to get the data. But you can't do that normally. You have a small sample set. And a lot of people are now saying, well, if you've got big data out there, social media and so on, we've got everything that's there, that's important. It's all there. We don't need to be careful. We just do the statistic, and it tells us what social media and what the real people are actually thinking. Then I want to lead on to another very serious issue. There's a fourth V of big data, the fifth V, some years ago, the veracity problem. Can we even trust the data that we're getting? I'll give you one or two little examples. And I'll lead on to a set of, 12 Vs of big data, the questions that you need to ask yourself if you are going to achieve the value that Sue was talking about, that we see in all of these kind of somewhat evangelical views, that if you do it, you see lots of case studies, we got 10% improvement in our revenue or in our profit margins or something. And so if everybody does that, you'll get that value. Really? You need to be careful. You need to be skeptical. I'm not saying cynical, but you need to be very, very skeptical of all of the claims about IT and about big data and big data analytics, if you are going to get value for yourself. Over the years, I've been watching the Standish Group reports from over the other side of the Atlantic. And they've been reporting ever since the very first chaos report in 1994. The number of IT-related projects which are successful, defined originally as on time to budget and delivering all of the contracted for functionality. Those which are the projects which failed, those that never delivered, maybe restarted several times, but didn't deliver. And the middle block, the challenge projects, late, over budget, and delivered a bit of the contracted for functionality. This is an annual survey of a lot of CIOs around the world. 50, 60,000 projects are assessed every year in this survey, chaos survey. And CIOs in the late 90s, early 2000s say, hang on, this is not right. Because, you know, we can't assess a project's success by delivering all of the contracted for functionality because the world moves on. You know, if we've got a 5-year project, it's going to what we need in 5 years is going to be different from what we want at the beginning. So please, could you change it to a definition on time, to budget, and delivering value? And they all thought that would increase the success rate. 2013, they reissued or changed the success rate and said, okay, you guys asked for it, here it is, on time, to budget, delivering value. And by the way, re-rate your projects the previous 2 years. Intriguingly, we've got to 39% successful projects on the old definition, and that year, 2012, when they recalibrated, 12% drop in so-called success. Now there's a challenge to all of us. Do IT projects deliver value at all? Oh, one more thing to go with this. There are some interesting questions about the consequences of those failures, the lack of value. If we think back to last year, our failures in security led to the better part of 1 billion sets of personal ID being stolen. Now the general metric is every single one of those cost the economy $200. So that's 200 billion cost per year purely on failed security at the trivialist level. We spend $3 trillion a year roughly on ICT in total. Let's say a trillion and a half is spent on developing, supporting, maintaining new stuff. And only, 30% delivers reasonable value. There are various metrics out there, various estimates that say that the waste and the on costs of working around all of these failures and all of these challenges is somewhere between $2 and $6 trillion a year. The world GDP is only $65 trillion. So just under 10%, may be wasted because of IT. So, as a set of backgrounds, let's think what we need to do to get value, to try and avoid being one of those challenged or failed or low value returning projects, because 60% of all big data projects do not deliver. Just like that lot. So why haven't we learned? What do we need to do to be successful? How can big data itself be the answer? We can see in physics, high energy particle physics, big data is there inherently, and we're doing an enormous amount of stuff that's quite interesting. The God particle. Or, as we heard in one of the sessions today, you can do an awful lot in big pharma. They're doing a fantastic job of using the big data carefully and effectively to reformulate things, to find amazing things from the human genome, leading up to almost individualized drugs for individual people. But big data, by and large, is built upon statistics. What happened in the past, and it's working on data that we have already collected. And by and large, most of those statistics calculate correlations. It's very difficult, unless you are incredibly careful and apply the scientific process with the various hypotheses, which we don't see happening in social media analytics by and large, you don't understand causation. If want to get value out of your big data, you have to get closer to causation, the why. And you only get that from small data. I mean, Lego are amazing. They did lots of work and they were losing market share fairly rapidly towards the end of the 20th century. And then they started getting one person who had an interest in small data to go and talk to people. He went, as it happened, he was talking to, I think it was the children of a friend of his, and found out what it was that was really critical in designing new Lego kits. And it was to do with a concept of mastery. And it came up, tumbled over that one, because the kid had got some really battered trainers, really sort of worn on two edges, outer edges or inner edges, I forget which, and it turned out he was a skateboarder. And the thing that was important to him as a kid, a 13-year-old skateboarder, was the fact that he could demonstrate mastery of skateboarding. He took that message back to Lego and they changed the way that they designed and the types of kits that they made, and they suddenly regained their market share that they were in danger of losing. So the small story from one kid led to the insight that could never have been found from big data. So yes, we can use analytics in all sorts of ways to find out what's happening within the data that we have, the patterns that Sue was mentioning. We can find the patterns, whether it's descriptive or predictive or other, any other description in the analytic, we find the patterns. There's a beautiful pattern out there about the, and it's a lovely graph, with a correlation coefficient R equals 0.998. Beautiful and totally spurious correlation between the tonnage of fresh lemons imported from Mexico into the USA, correlated year by year with a number of road deaths in the USA. Almost perfect correlation and perfectly spurious. Predictives, I hate the term predictive because it implies we have a crystal ball. I used to be a project financial analyst. We used to produce star diagrams to show the sensitivity analysis of the 30-year, 40-year life cycle forecast for the jet engines that Rolls-Royce made. They were star charts. They gave us an idea of the sort of things that might happen, how costs might or might not change, how the market share might or might not change, and so on and so forth. That was just modelling. And everybody using it understood that this was just a sort of a way of looking at the forecast. We didn't dress it up with that today's modern jargon, predictive. And now we'll dwell on this a little bit sometime, perhaps. Many, particularly in the social media analysis, say, oh, we go into Twitter, we go onto Facebook, we go onto the hotel and cafe and restaurant rating websites, and we take that data and that tells us everything we need to know. We've got all the data we need. In statistics terms, N equals all. Have you ever thought about your own individual behavior? Marketeers have known this for, to my knowledge, I had it mentioned to me by a marketeer in the mid-80s. If I am happy with a service, a restaurant, I might possibly tell three people. If I'm hacked off, I will tell at least 10. So if you look at the ratings, you will always find at least a 10 to 3 or even a 10 to 1 negative to positive. 5 years ago or thereabouts, Santander started using Twitter analysis to find out what was happening. It would have been so easy to pick up from that and then use that as the whip to punish those who had service failures in their branches. Very wisely, they said, no, this is an early warning that might indicate there might be a problem. Go find the small data that tells you what's really happening. Just don't rely on the statistics. Netflix, when they do a new, want to do a new type of program, they will do several different types of trial runs. You know, those first episode to see what the market likes. They will do all the data analytics on the viewing and everything else. And then they will take a human-based decision, overriding, taking advantage and account of the big data, but not letting it work. Whereas other organizations do it the other way. Big data, oh, we'll take the one that has the highest rating and we'll then run that. And the company that did that failed dismally. They didn't use the human intelligence. The other problem with statistics is it only tells you what happened in the past. We don't know what the future will be. One of the most interesting to me examples is over the last 40 years, to my knowledge, the big world econometric models have changed or broken every 10 years and then been reconstituted. These are the great kind of, what are the tools and the levers of power to manage our economies. And then it broke in 2008. And no one has recreated an econometric model that works. No government, no central bank has the foggiest idea what will happen when quantitative easing is unwound. We have been running now for what? 9 years with no effective predictive model or econometric model that works. So the past may not be the same as today, which is the present, and it may or may not be what's happening in the future. And yes, we can bring in the weather. Who remembers that lovely October a few years ago when it suddenly was very, very warm? And all of the supermarkets managed to fail to provide enough salads for a week or two. Because you can't ramp it up. Sue said, the rate of data is now doubling every 18 months. Moore's law now applies to data. And the veracity problem, as mentioned by John Easton a few years ago, is that 80% of all the data around us is of uncertain veracity. Not that it's not true, not right, but we haven't a clue how to actually identify the data that is correct, or are correct, and the data that are not correct, and by how much. Now I got a fabulous example of this. Most of you got smartphones. How many of you got location services switched on? How many tagged your photos with location services? Don't believe it. Only if you're taking a series of photos in one place can you believe where it is. I was at the top of Montreal in Montreal 3 years ago, 2 years ago, and took a photo at the very top where you would expect to see every single satellite that was there. And the first photo was 4.5 kilometers out of place. A year before that, I was down in Santiago, or in Chile, at a academic conference, and we went for the sort of conference dinner, or lunch, about halfway down to Valparaiso. And I took a series of 4 or 5 photos of inside the restaurant, which was a wooden roof, of the 4 beautiful dishes. 3 of those photos were kind of in the right sort of area, within 100, 150 meters. The other one was 22.9 kilometers away. There's an organization called ThinkNear that looks at a lot of location-based advertising, billions of adverts each year, that targeted at people who the advertisers think are in a particular place. 14% of all of those locations are targeted 60 plus miles from where the phone actually is. I've had students working on this problem now for 3 years for their final year dissertation projects. We're building some very interesting data sets about accuracy of location services on smart devices. It means you can't trust it. You can't trust tweets and ratings, you have to think very carefully about the veracity of the data that you have got and how important it is to have perfectly accurate or just enough accurate. You've got to work out for your business problem, how much data can I afford to have which is not correct. If you've got and you're in financial services and you're using it like Experian use data to give credit ratings, which are used by banks and so on, to actually approve or disapprove loan requests, what happens if they start connecting to social media profiles and get the wrong connection? And you've got John Smith. There's an awful lot of John Smiths in this country. How do you know you've got the right one? What is your vulnerability as a company for making a decision based on incorrect data that is is lifestyle threatening at least? Coming up to the end, folks. So I said 27,002. We saw 27,001, which is a certification for information governance and security. I prefer 27,002 because it gives you a lot of interesting questions that you need to ask. Three pillars from the first section. Risk assessment, understand the risk to your organization for this particular project or this particular type of business, and then think about compliance with external obligations, laws, etc., regulations, and compliance with your internal procedures. And then ask yourself 12 V questions. The original three, velocity, variety, volume, because they affect technical architectures, as we've been hearing today on the HPC side. It also affects our own analytics, whether you're using SAS or what's an analytics, what's in cognitive. Value, what value are you going to get? Don't jump on a bandwagon just because it's there. Ask the question, what is the value to the various stakeholders? It could be your customers, it could be you, it could be your suppliers. And ask what value is defined as. Is it really pound notes or is it something else? Most of us use one or other of the weather apps. It has no monetary value whatsoever to me. It's interesting, it's useful, but it doesn't have monetary value to me on that one. Lots of other things have monetary value, but there are also things like time. And then there are these extra Vs that my students came up with a few years ago. The data, is it variable? Is it stable? What are the patterns in that variability? How does that affect the value I might get from doing analytics on the data? And these Vs don't apply just to big data, but to any analytics project. In fact, almost to any IT project or any business project. If you ask yourself these sort of questions, maybe you'll avoid being one of those failures that get no value. You may be successful. Thank you very much. Does anybody want to ask a question of the other two?